Now, I thank Tafara, my friend from South Africa, for telling us that our sound wasn't working. But guess what? We didn't have it on. So it wasn't working when I thanked it. So Tafara, thank you very much for pointing out we have a new cable and the problem is fixed. And so thanks for recommending this road to go. And then thanks for pointing it out. And then my good friend Walter Muddy, who is an evangelist and spent much of his life over in South America having children. And I think he had 4 children born over there, him and his wife. So a selfless act to move in. And he's like the deep jungle. So thank you, Walter. You're not old, Walter. It was our sound system. Your ears are blessed and highly favored. Then this morning, the Holy Spirit just showed me this little passage in Proverbs 31. It's pretty powerful. It's a lot of it, starting with verse 10. I'm not going to read there. It talks about a wife of noble character. But I'm just going to go further. I'm just going to pick up in verse 25. When I was reading this, in all honesty, it just reminded me a lot of my wife. And so I'm going to read this, but I think it applies to a lot of wives and mothers out there. And this is how we should look at them. We need to look at whether a mother's doing the best job or the worst job. It's okay for us to still love them and to still reach out and still try. One thing God showed me years ago to set me free from, strongly disliking my father was, as terrible as he was, that was the best he could do at that time. I ended up going from hating, like deep hatred and anger, to compassion, to thinking how terrible it must be to, when you're a kid and you're dreaming, I'm going to be a mom, and I'm going to be this wonderful mom, and I'm going to have this wonderful husband, and then it doesn't work out that way. I don't think any parent as a little child says, someday I'm going to be a monster. I think it's something that the devil gets in and society gets in, and it gets developed, But everybody's reachable. God, many of us sitting right here, Jesus had literally reached down from heaven and shake us to get our lives going the right way, right? So, and some of us, we think back and we go, wow, he really started on me as a little kid and I was how old before, right? So let's not give up on people. Let's love on them. Doesn't mean you should put yourself in a situation to be abused, You shouldn't do that, but let's love on them. Anyway, Proverbs 31, starting with verse 25, she is clothed with strength and dignity, and she laughs without fear of the future. When she speaks, her words are wise, and she gives instruction with kindness. She carefully watches everything in her household and suffers nothing from laziness. Her children stand and bless her. Her husband praises her. There are many virtuous and capable women in the world, but you surpass them all. Charm is, I'll stop right there. So, I hope that describes if you're a husband, I hope that describes how you feel about your wife and children. That's how you should reverence and look at your mom. And even if she doesn't deserve that kind of reverence, just love on her, Love can really just change things. When I was struggling, not struggling with my relationship with Jesus, but I was having a hard time getting it to grow, and that's what he kept drilling into me, because as we know, like our generation, like Kevin, right, we didn't grow up with the loving and all lovey-dovey, and it just wasn't in my area, it just wasn't a word that men used. It was a sign of weakness and all that stuff. So to tell Jesus you love them was a big step for me, then to say I'll allow you to love me was a huge step. And so love does change everything and does, so. All right, we will finish up today. So last week we started on life more abundantly and talking about how we can have that. And we can absolutely have that. And a lot of Christians are not experiencing that. And we can't guilt ourselves if we're in a tough spot. But what we can do, if you're struggling financially or with a sickness or anything, we can still praise God. We can still put a smile on our face. We can still say, everything in my life is not where I want to be, but I'm on my way there. As Barry Bennett, one of our Bible teachers, says, I really love the way he teaches a lot. When he said he could be seeing, if you're sick and you're throw it up and you're all that, and someone says, how are you, you know, are you sick? No, I'm not sick, right? He's like, you don't say that. You say, I'm battling through it. You know, I'm battling. We don't just lay down and sacrifice a whole day to being sick, or a whole day to being whining about our finances, because, you know, words have power. If you keep speaking, how you feel, and say, oh, terrible. Guess what? It's not going to change. How's your finances? Broke, you know? Nothing in the bank. That's what you're going to have, you know? So you got to speak. It's not right. Just speak what you want, you know? Just speak it forth, and just use common sense. So, you know, Christians, we should walk around, and people should look at us and see the abundant life. And the abundant life, you know, people always think abundance, they always think money, you know? Being secure and not, you know, being able to pay your bills and all that is part of it, but it's a small part of it, because people look at you, they don't see your wallet, they don't see your bank statement. You know, most of us don't walk around with our bank statements taped to our forehead, but they see your face, they see your smile, they know your attitude, they know your kindness. That's abundant. If you, in this day and age, if you can have an abundance of kindness, that's pretty good, you know? And I've been able to do much better at that since I've been off social media. You know, social media was not giving me much kindness. I'm still a patriot, so I'm still ready to take up arms if necessary. Just because I'm being kind doesn't mean I'm not a patriot, you know? I want to change the world with love.
Are you insinuating that patriots aren't kind?
No. No, I'm not insinuating. I'm just saying...
Social media is...
I'm just saying I can be kind, and I can be a Christian, and I can also... if necessary, protect our country by all means necessary. You know, if people think it's a stupid statement for a Christian to make, but you got to look at the big picture. If America falls, the world falls, right? Yeah. And so a lot of things that you do, it's unselfish, right? Jesus said there is no greater love than someone who lay down their life for a friend. And so many of our service, many, many servicemen, we wouldn't be here today if our service people didn't do that. Men and women, of course. So back on track, right? So this whole thing came about when God kept speaking to me about Psalms 23, and then it was combined with John 10:10, which is a scripture, a foundational scripture for the church. It says, the thief comes only in order to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have and enjoy life and have it in abundance, to the full, to it overflows. And that's the life we're supposed to have, life in abundance, to the full, to it overflows. We went through John 6:1-13, and I'm not going to read it all again, but I will just go over some of the highlights. In verse 4, Jesus said, where shall we buy the bread? This is the feeding of the 5,000, right? And 5,000 men, and then women and children, probably about 15,000. And it wasn't the point I wanted to bring out there. It wasn't the disciples or the people going, where's the food? Where's the food? How are we going to do it? It was Jesus saw the need, and he brought up, you know, that the need needs to be taken care of. So Jesus said, where should we buy? Jesus said to them, where should we buy bread? It was Jesus' idea to feed his sheep. They didn't have to beg. Jesus wanted to feed them. Jesus wants to bless you. He wants to take care of you. He's on your biggest revelation. God put in my brain was, you might have to shut those windows, that, you know, Jesus is on our side. You know, he's on our side. And in verse 7, Philip was thinking small. He said, even if we, you know, had spent 200 denarii, which is 200 days pay, we're only going to have enough food, you won't even have enough food for everyone to have a little. So Philip was thinking very small. Often we think small, you know, if I can just get this one bill paid when you have 20 bills, you know, if I can just get enough food for today when, you know, God wants you to have plenty. God doesn't want you stressed out, you know, the days of, you know, not wanting to get the mail because you didn't want the bills. Those days, you know, as we get older and walk in faith, those days need to be behind us, you know, not in front of us. So think big. Philip was small thinking, and, you know, he was focused on what we didn't have. Verse 8 says, this is my paraphrase. But often we look at what we have as not enough instead of blessing it. If you keep cursing what little you have, it's never going to grow, right? You can't look at your bank account and go, you're terrible, you have nothing in you, what am I going to do with this? You got to bless it and speak to it. And same with anything, healing. If you have 90% sickness in your body, and I pray that's not your case, but you have 10% health, right? Praise Lord for that 10%. Praise God that you can move your lips and speak to anything, you know. I've heard stories of paraplegics, you know, they start to pray for a finger, you know, and the finger starts to move, and like, thank you, Jesus, for that finger. Now, next finger, get up and get, you know, and they just go. So just be thankful for what you have. And that goes for everything. Don't curse what you have, but bless it, and it will multiply. If you need money, bless it, it will multiply. You need health, bless it, it will multiply. You need friends, bless the one you have. And they'll multiply. Jesus gave thanks to what he had, and it multiplied. We know he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and they fed 15,000, and there was plenty left over. They were filled, not just barely enough, but there was leftovers. That's the overflow he's talking about for our lives. You know, we're not supposed to limp through life and just get to the door of heaven and fall through. I can't believe I made it, you know. I'm going to sprint in like, yeah, you know. Where's the pond? Where's the turtles? Where's the ice rink? Let's get this thing going, right? Let's get moving. Let's have some fun. So, we're not going to just barely make it over the line, you know. We might have to, you know, we might be in a position where maybe we got to throw some people over our shoulders, right? And bring them in, but that's not going to be us. In Mark 6:34, New King James Version, this is Mark's version of the feeding the 5,000, but just one verse. It says, "And Jesus, when he came out, saw a great multitude, and he was moved with compassion for them." So one thing we need to understand is Jesus doesn't look at you when you're messing up or when we're not living that life more abundantly and get angry or disappointed. He's never mad at you, and he's not disappointed. He looks at compassion. And being parents, a lot of us in here are parents, or even if you have little brothers or siblings or friends and you see them doing the wrong thing, you know, you can get like a little bit of righteous anger, but overall it's compassion. You're like, oh man, if you just listen to me, your life could be so much easier, right? So you have compassion when you see people messing up. And Jesus has looked at everybody that was in need, and he had compassion. Because they were like sheep not having a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. And, you know, as Christians, when you see people that their lives are going the wrong way, I find a lot of people don't want to be lectured to. And, you know, if God tells you to lecture him or talk about heaven and hell, because he's put that in my brain sometimes, whatever the Holy Spirit tells you, go with. But sometimes, you know, you're talking to someone, they've maybe never heard a Bible story, or they've walked away from Jesus, and they just need to be taught. You know, Jesus had compassion, and he began to teach them. And you see that throughout Scripture. Jesus would teach, and then he'd preach, and he'd heal. Because a lot of times before someone can be preached to, they got to be taught. You know, I learn a lot from watching my wife, Brenda. You know, kids, we have the teenagers and stuff in the house all the time. And sometimes I just want to go preaching to them. And she'd take out the Bible and she'd just sit down and start going through stuff, you know. And sometimes, you know, before someone will listen, they need to be taught. You know, the other thing about being a teacher is, I mean, we talk about our busy lifestyle. And Jesus, you know, I'm sure he was being pulled in many directions, right? He has to only say what God tells him to say. So he's got to be tuned into God all the time. And then once you raise someone from the dead or make a hand grow out or cure leprosy, you're pretty popular, right? I mean, he had a hard time getting away. But he still showed that he cared. Right? And a lot of times people want to know that we actually care, especially being Christians. Oh, you want my money, you want to fill your church. I honestly don't care about numbers and money and all that stuff. You know, I want to reach as many people, but, you know, God is not, you know, not, luckily I've never been one. You know, when this church was founded, it was never about numbers or income or anything like that. It was about trying to, for me, selfishly, I'm trying to do what God tells me to do. And God told me to preach. And be a minister, so that's why I'm doing it. But Jesus took the time. He didn't just walk by and, you know, throw a scripture at the, you know, he said that he taught them. So, you know, if you see someone that needs teaching, take some time and teach them. Because a lot of times I say, I don't have time for that. And then I'll think of the thing that I'm going to do that I don't have time to help this person. And it's not that important. You know, the lawn can be mowed later. You know, I will get to it. I promise. I just got the look like, I'm getting to it.
I saw the head bob.
Well, the other day, you know it's bad when your wife says, you know what? Why don't we go next door and get all our giant tortoises and put them in the yard so they can eat the grass? Maybe they'll mow the lawn, right? So we did. We got a bunch of big tortoises and put them in the yard, and
they had a good time.
They had a good time. We're going to keep going with that method. No carburetor troubles. No, don't matter if you hit a rock. You don't have to. No flat tires. No hitting a rock. And I can blame it on the tortoise. How great is that? We didn't really get around the pool. I don't know. I put Esmeralda out there. I don't know what she was doing, you know? So, pretty good. So I'm going to read through Psalms 23 in the Amplified Version real quick. It's a Psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, to feed, to guide, and to shield me. I shall not want. He lets me lay down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still and quiet waters. He refreshes and restores my soul, my life. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the sunless valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod to protect and your staff to guide, they comfort and console me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed and refreshed my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy and unfailing love shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell forever throughout all my days in the house and in the presence of the Lord. And that scripture is for today. It's not just heaven, it's for earth. You know, it's been studied out, and it is for today. We are supposed to walk through. You know, things might come at us, but we walk through. You know, in martial arts, we used to have the gauntlet. I don't know if you guys are, right? You have to walk through. You have all these people lined up. And, you know, in Chinatown, we have, you know, it was a long school. We have to walk through. And people can just attack you in any way. And you got to defend it and sometimes disable and keep going. You know, if you didn't disable, if they had, like, you know, a sword or just kick you, you wanted to make it so that they didn't want to attack a second time, right? And Chinatown was pretty hardcore, it was pretty fun. But you walk through, you know? You made it through. You might have got a few bumps and bruises, but at the end of it, you walk through. And even if you got hit a little bit sore, you look back and go, yes, conquered that. You were just full of joy. Didn't worry about licking your wounds. You're like, got through. And so Jesus will take us through that. You know, it doesn't say things won't come against us, but we'll get through it because the scripture says he's yoked with us, right? We can't get away from him. As long as we want him there, he's there. So it turns out when you study the feeding of the 5,000, right, it was near the Sea of Galilee, and you listen to the words, when Jesus said, have them sit down, make them sit down on the grass. It said there's much grass there. That word sit down is anapipto. Nailed it. Anapipto, and that means to make to lie down. And so Jesus right there was demonstrating Psalms 23 right there in front of everybody. He's telling them, you know, lay down in the green pasture, right? And they were hungry, and what did he do? He fed them, took care of them. They didn't starve. He took them through. And they say during the day like that, the sea was calm. So he's making them lie down and eat and take care of them before, you know, in front of still waters. And then we're going to jump up to John 6, 16 through 21. That evening, Jesus' disciples went down to the shore to wait for him. But as darkness fell and Jesus still hadn't come back, they got into the boat and headed across the lake toward Capernaum. Soon a gale swept down upon them and the sea grew very rough. They had rowed 3 or 4 miles when suddenly they saw Jesus walking on the water toward the boat. They were terrified, but he called out to them, "Don't be afraid, I am here." Then they were eager to let him in the boat, and immediately they arrived at their destination. And a lot of translation, he translated. So the boat just supernaturally, boom, went right where it needed to be. So here you see during the day, the sea is calm. He's lying down. He's feeding him. He's demonstrating Psalms 23 right there. But then you see here, now the storm comes, right? And still with Psalm 23, they called out to Jesus. He said, "Don't be afraid, I am here." And they're in a storm, rough waters, and instantly he brought them through. Just like it says in Psalm 23, you walk through, right? And Jesus right here just brought them right through. So I just thought it was very powerful. If you study John chapter 6 and you study Psalm 23 together, it's pretty powerful, and you can literally see Psalm 23 being lived out. And so during the day, it's calm. They had a little storm. They were hungry. Jesus took care of it, brought them through. That night, they're walking. They're 3-4 miles out, rowing the boat in a storm. Jesus just come walking right through the storm and translated them right to where they need to go. There's no storm or any situation that God, who created the universe, can't handle. Sometimes we magnify stuff. Well, a headache we can believe for, but if it's bigger, it's too big for God. And Jesus showed there is nothing too big. I mean, he made hands grow. He raised people from the dead. All right? So I don't know what more evidence we need to see. And if you study Josephus, the Jewish historian, all these things that, we shouldn't need, as mature Christians, anything outside the Bible to believe the Word. But I know coming up through and believing the Word, especially Noah's Ark, because I teach a lot on animals and stuff, evidence on that and evidence of that. And one day the Holy Spirit spoke to me and showed me a print. It's great that, you know, maybe they'll find the Ark, maybe they won't. It's great you see all this archaeology type, you know what I'm saying, evidence, right? And but the only evidence we need is the Word. Ultimately, we have to get to the point where we just need the Word. God says it, and yes, we believe it, right? And that's not dumb. That's actually faith. So John 10:1-10, and I'm going to read it in the Amplified, and it's called the Parable of the Good Shepherd. I assure you, and most solemnly say to you, he who does not enter by the door into the sheepfold, but climbs up from some other place, that one is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep, the protector and the provider. The doorkeeper opens the gate for this man, and the sheep hear his voice and pay attention to it. And knowing that they listen, he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out to pasture. When he has brought all of his sheep outside, he walks on ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice and recognize his call. They will never follow a stranger, but will run away from him because they do not know the voice of a stranger, the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was talking about. So Jesus said again, I assure you and most solemnly say to you, I am the door for the sheep leading to life. All who came before me as false messiahs and self-appointed leaders are thieves and robbers, but the true sheep did not hear them. I am the door. Anyone who enters through me will be saved and will live forever and will go in and out freely and find pasture, spiritual security. The thief comes only in order to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have and enjoy life and have it in abundance to the full till it overflows. So a few things I want to point out there. One new thing that the Holy Spirit showed me last night and then this morning when I was reading through this. It says there are many false prophets and messiahs that are stealing and robbing. And that's true today. If you're hooked on a preacher because the show of the church or how many people in the church or his following, you have to look at the fruit that he's producing outward to the community, to the people, to the world. What is he producing beyond his own house, right? A friend of mine, I was on a meeting with the founder of Black Lives Matter. He's, you know, an African-American man, and he's smart, and they've been wanting him and wanting him and wanting him. So he agreed to a Zoom meeting, and he asked a question. He said, you've taken in tons of money, millions upon millions of dollars. And I just saw, because they had privy to private information, but I think it's public notice now, maybe not all of it, but that you bought 6 mansions. 6. And the founder of Black Lives Matter and said, yes, we did. And he said, I thought you were supposed to be helping the poor black community. And this woman, the founder of BLM, said to my friend and to everyone else on this, yes, and that starts with me and my family. I bought a mansion for myself and 5 mansions for people in my family. That's what they did with their money. So all the people that gave to BLM, what didn't go to the Democratic Party, went to buy mansions for their family. And then they muted him and wouldn't let him speak again. And then someone else called them on something, and they muted that person. The only people that got to join their group and support them and stay unmuted were the people that were okay with it. And so, you know, that's not okay. And for churches, you know, there's a lot of good churches. You know, I don't personally know any churches that do this kind of stuff. But you just, you know, you don't want to follow someone. We should be producing fruit. You know, when we pray for people, they should be healed. You know, instantly is best. If not, we should see something, right? People should be coming here and being set free and be getting words. And if not, then we need to talk and figure out, why aren't we hearing stuff? Why aren't we producing the fruit God tells us to produce? The other thing might be more subtle that the Holy Spirit was showing me. Churches where you just go in, check the box, and sit there and nothing. Nothing happens. I mean, when we used to go to a church, if someone needed prayer, we prayed powerfully before we put the camera on, because we wanted to make it an in-house thing. We didn't want it to be a big public thing. But, you know, we spoke to it. Tammy led in prayer, and she said, God, if it be your will, you know, she spoke to the situation, took her authority, and we all agreed and commanded and spoke, prayed in the Spirit and whatever we needed to do. We used to go to a church where if someone had a prayer request, they'd write it on a piece of paper and put it in a hat or a box or whatever, and then the pastor would, you know, read it or something, you know. That's nothing. That's doing absolutely nothing. So if you go into a church that's just a dead church, they're not Spirit-filled, they're not doing the Word, they're not producing, they're still afraid to open their doors, that's another way you're being robbed, because you think you're doing the right thing, but you're not. That's, remember, the devil is very subtle. In the garden, he didn't come in as a dinosaur, a big T-Rex, and step, you know, grab Adam and Eve and shake them. This is what you're going to do. He came in as a little lowly serpent, and they could have stepped on him. They could have picked him up and flung him. They could have cut his head off. They could have did whatever they wanted, but they listened because it was subtle, right? So, you know, if you're in a church that's just not producing, then you got to pray and see if it's, you know, maybe you're going to be like Greg Moore and stay there and change that church, right? Or maybe God's calling you somewhere else. So I don't know. But just be careful that we're not listening to false preachers and prophets and stuff. And so, all right, how do we have life and have it more abundantly? I'm going to read a couple of scriptures before we end here, because that is God's goal for us. And we just have to remember that if things are being stolen from you, your health, relationship, finances, do not blame God. So many people blame, I'm mad at God. It's ridiculous to be mad at the creator of the universe, who loves you more than anything. And, you know, God revealed to me a year ago, I'm terrible at time, you know, that, you know, even my young days, even when I quit drinking and thought I'd do it on my own, that he was there with me, because he said, remember when we did this? He's always there ruling you, guiding you, loving you. We just don't recognize him, because to hear his voice, we have to be his sheep. We want to have to tune in. We have to learn, right? And that takes time. It takes a relationship. So remember, anything that's being stolen, stealing, killing, destroying, right? All devil, never God, right? Life, more abundant till it, you know, till it overflows, God. It's pretty simple. Ephesians 3:20, the Amplified Version, I must have been hooked on the Amplified Version during the study, huh? Says, now to him who is able to carry out his purpose and do super abundantly more than we can ask or think, infinitely beyond our greatest prayers, hopes, or dreams, according to his power that is at work within us. So God can do more, I love that word, super abundantly. I had to add it to my dictionary because it didn't recognize it as a word, but God can do more, do super abundantly, more than we can ask, think, dream, pray, hope. He can do more than that, and here's the key, according to the power that is at work within us. That power, when you give your life to Jesus and get baptized in the Holy Spirit, giving your life to Jesus gets to your heaven. Getting baptized with the Holy Spirit gives you that power. Okay, you need both of them. They should really be done. The day you give your life to Jesus, best you get baptized in the Holy Spirit right there. If not, and you haven't done it, it's something you got to do. And then once you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, you got to pray in the Spirit. So that power is at work within us now. And so we don't have to rain the heavens down. Jesus, please come. You know, we don't have to, you know, go to a certain place, a certain temple or church. We don't need to do that. We need to go to a quiet place to hear his voice to get that relationship. But he's already inside of us. Okay, we don't have to, you know, all pray for 4 hours before the church service so the presence of the Holy Spirit shows up. It's here. Whether we feel it, receive it, recognize that that's on us. But every single church service, the Holy Spirit's here, Jesus is there, wherever you go. If you're not here at church today and you're out in the field or you're at the beach or you're somewhere, guess what? He's there with you too. He doesn't go, oh, I told you I'd meet you at church today and here you are at the beach. Guess you're on your own. That's not how it works. You should come to church because you might be somebody here that needs a word from you. God might show you something. You know, but wherever you are, he's with you. The following scripture, I think, is key to experience a life more abundant. And this will end with this. John 6:63, New King James Version. There you go. Right? I see some smiles from Tammy and Brenda and Deborah.
No passion?
Huh?
No passion?
No passion. You know what I said? I just didn't... I like the Passion Translation. I do like, whenever I read the Passion Translation, I do need to read New King James or American Standard or something else with it, but I do like it. But New King James. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. I'm going to say it again. It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. That's Jesus. So let's just look at that real quick. The flesh profits you nothing. How much time do people spend worried about how they look, what they're going to wear? Jesus even said, why are you worried about, you know, what you wear and what you eat and all that? You know, Solomon in all his glory, right? All his money, all his clothes, wasn't clothed as brilliant as the lilies of the field who are here today and gone tomorrow, right? So we worry, and sure, it's okay, you know, dress for success, and there's a lot of studies that say that, you know, people that dress better make more and gives you your self-esteem. And again, I was looking at one of those studies the other day. Someone was talking about a Christian person, you know, how if you want to be successful, dress better and all this. And if you dress in sweatpants, you're not going to make as much money and all these studies. And I'm like, yeah, it makes sense. I've heard all this before. But then God's like, you know what? If you have a relationship with me, I don't care what you're wearing. You can wear, I like sweat. I only wear pants when I have to. I mean, I wear pants, but I like if I have to, but I like to wear just sweatpants, driving in a hockey rink, or, you know, if I go on a long ride, you know, I speak in Pennsylvania in a couple weeks, and hopefully my boy Alex will see the healing enough so he'll take that trip with me. I'm not going to drive to Pennsylvania in jeans. I'm going to drive there in sweatpants and change in the back of my van before I get on stage, right? So, you know, we worry so much. People, I can't go on stage or I can't come up on the camera because I have this pimple or my clothes aren't right. I'm having a bad hair day, right? There's nothing wrong with trying to make yourself look nice, but that can't stop you from doing things, right? And if you have somebody that truly loves you, it's for husbands and wives, you'll know what I'm talking about, because any wife can look at, especially as we get a little older, right, can look at someone and go, you know, they have a better body, they have a better physique, they have better this, right? And they look at their husband and they see that inner beauty, they see the heart the way Jesus does, and to that wife, that man is everything. And to that man, you know, I think my wife is the most beautiful woman on the planet, you know? And every good husband looks at their wife and that's what they say. And other men don't see it, but they're not supposed to see it, you know? Especially in the young jealous days, someone look at my wife. She has no idea how many people I hit that she doesn't know about. She knows about a few, but there's been all, you know, you're young and you're jealous and you got everyone chasing you. Well, I'm glad that I think she's more beautiful than anyone else thinks she is, right? So it's the flesh doesn't profit you anything. We spend so much time now with social media, Instagram, TikTok, you know, Snap. I don't even know all these. Everybody, well, this one looks this way, and this one looks this way, and this one has $300 sneakers, and this one only has $10 sneakers, right? I had it in my own house. It's ridiculous. It profits you nothing. I was listening to a little interview by Alice Cooper. Yes?
Yeah.
Love Alice Cooper. And Me and Brenda got to go see him in concert. We were like 20 feet away at this little place, and he stayed in the same hotel. It was awesome, right?
This is probably like 17, 18 years ago.
Yes, but still, we got to see Alice Cooper like this close. So I see him from a distance. Me and Rob were talking about that. She's like, I've seen him like a dozen times, but I always saw him in big stadiums, and we saw him in this little teeny place. And he said, you know what? I was a preacher's kid. My grandfather was a preacher. My father was a preacher. My wife's parents were preachers. He said, I went off. I did every drug. I owned every kind of house and every kind of car. And at the end of the day, there was a hole in my heart. And I realized it's just a house. It's just a car. You can have them all. You can live in them all. You can drive them all. You can travel the world. You can do it all. No matter what you do, if Jesus is not the center of your heart, you're always going to find that empty spot. So Alice Cooper came full circle. Grew up a preacher's kid, you know, and then... you know, this interview is pretty new. And he's like, you know, without Jesus. And he's like, I'm new. He's like, I consider myself new at this. He's like, I'm heavily pursuing my relationship with Jesus because he wants to, you know, he knows there's nothing else can fill that hole in his heart except a relationship with Jesus. So the flesh, it profits you nothing. These are words of Jesus. And we don't know better. TikTok does not know better than Jesus, right? Social media can be used for good like we're doing, or it can be used for evil, stealing your time. Just stealing your time, you know. You've got to get to the point where, you know, you see yourself the way Jesus sees you. Jesus looks at you. God looks at you the way he sees Jesus. Perfect. I think it's Colossians 1:22. I'm pretty sure it's Colossians. If somebody feels like looking up, go ahead. It says that he sees you perfect and without blemish. So when you look in the mirror, who's right? You or Jesus? Who's right? If someone says you're ugly, you're this, you're that, you're too short, too tall, too heavy, too skinny, right? If someone says something to you or about you that does not line up with the word of God, then someone's wrong and it's not God, right? Don't give people, I just spoke this to a school, this what's coming on me now, to these kids, these school age kids, and I'm like, do not give someone the power to ruin your day or your life. Who cares? It says in John, I think, 8 around 44, Jesus is talking, the people aren't receiving his word, you know, because they're, hey, who are you? You know, we're Paul, Abraham. He's like, you follow your father, the devil, the father of all lies. If somebody is telling you something that doesn't line up with the word, they are lying to you. Whether they know it or not, they are outright lying. So why would a lie change your day? You know, what the word of God says is true. And you need to see yourself. God looks at your heart, right? And you know, everybody here, I know it, people here have a good heart. And even if you feel like you're evil and you're a monster, deep inside there's a spark for you. And Jesus will get that spark and he'll light it and it will grow. So you've got to, the words I speak to you are in spirit and they are life. Words from the spirit are life, and praying in tongues, that's what you've got to do. You've got to pray in the Spirit as much as possible. I'm going to end. If you've never given your life to Jesus, now is the time to do it. And mothers, have a great day today. Husbands and kids, spoil your wives and moms today. Don't let them clean anything. Step up to the plate. But right now, if you've never given your life to Jesus, it's this simple. Say, Jesus, I believe that you died for my sins. I know that through God's Holy Spirit, you were raised from the grave 3 days later. And I ask you to come into my heart and spend eternity with me. I thank you because I prayed that you were with me. And I am now a Christian. In Jesus' name, we all say, amen. Amen. Unfortunately...